let us discuss today the rise of the modern nation state, a lecture within which we will define some key concepts. Concepts that are essential to understanding politics in Central and Eastern Europe in the last 100 to 200 years, but also today. Without understanding these concepts and how they played out, how these realities were formed in the Central and Eastern Europe in the period we're discussing, there's no way you can understand, or anyone can understand, politics today in Central and Eastern Europe. Therefore, you need to pay close attention and take good notes, please. So, the rise of the modern state. What you see here, and it's these materials are of course on Canvas, is a map of the world today. It's I think 2013. And what do you see, right? The world is depicted as a patch, as a patchwork of variously colored, you know, entities, right? Now, is this actually the how the world looks? If you fly by in a satellite or an airplane, is this how it looks? Oh, no, right? So what is the difference? What is it? Why don't you see these on a map? What are these that you see, right? These are, what we see here, are borders that seem to depict individual political entities. Now, what you have to understand is that never in the history of humankind, never, in the history of humankind, was the world organized this way, until modernity. That never in the history of humankind was the world covered completely with political entities of the type we know and we see on this map, of the type of sovereign political entities, never in this world. And this whole process actually happened since basically the 19th century. Late 18th century, and since the 19th century. And this is when it all happened, and today we got to the point that there is no, basically no inhabitable place on Earth, except for some rocks in the ocean or whatever, some tiny islands, but there is no inhabitable place on Earth that is not assigned to a state. Okay? So here we get to the first important concept that we need to define, that of state. What is a state? And you need to understand exactly what we mean by state, because it's not the same as, for example, that the way the word is used, you know, in the United States. So, what is a state, right? A state, as you can see, and you can guess, right? A state is a set of institutions that have sovereign power over a territory and the membership. So a state is a set of institutions that have sovereign power over a territory and the membership. This is why we can talk about borders, because borders, again, they don't exist actually, right? They don't. It's not even, you know, there are few borders that are actually, you know, marked so that every single meter, feet, foot, whatever, yard is you know, marked with a fence and so on, right? Borders are what? Are conventions between governments, right? Between states. And borders are defined by, as I said, a set of institutions. This means that today, each state that functions is supposed to have a centralized central government, which rules, which orders a set of institutions that cover the land, from the postal office to the taxation institution to the military to the border patrol to you know, health services to transportation to trains to whatever, depending on how it is organized. But basically, all of them respond to one center of power, and they cover the land. So that if you call 911 in this corner of the land or in that corner of the land, it has the same result. There's no patch that does not fall under the power of this government. But understand that this idea that the government has all these set of institutions, which means a set of people who day after day perform the same function and listen to the same commands and cover the entire territory, an entire territory, and there's no place where you can hide from them, basically. Right? They will find you and they have the right to find you. This is very recent, and you notice that it only could become possible once certain developments took place, once there was a revolution in transportation, communication, and so on. This is when such a thing can happen. Notice also that such a state needs money to pay all these people who do those jobs, people dressed as postal workers who do the same thing every day, every corner of the land, people dressed as military, and so on and so on. And that money is extracted from whom? From the same land and the same population, through taxation, and that's also down to institutions. Now, never in history did we have such an all-encompassing, huge behemoth of a state. So this is a modern phenomenon, right? The phenomenon of the modern state. But there's another, and I posted here, actually, links to how the world looked in different other points in time. And they're instructive to see, to understand how this has changed. So here's the world in 1800 BC, right? And these are not even, these are civilizations that we know of, not even states as we understand them today. And you see all these white patches. These white patches mean that there were no people there. Of course not. Right? But we don't have the marks, the remains of how, of civilizations, which is, means that you didn't have enough of a strong and developed political power that could mobilize the resources to build, let's say, pyramids, as we they did in Egypt, which is why you know about ancient Egypt. It's not like you didn't have political organization. Any human society that exists is organized, right? There's no society without organization. There's no society without politics, right? But some leave marks, some don't leave marks, but none of these was on this model, right? And you go further to 1000 BC and 500 BC, and for example, here you see the Greek city-states, right? We know about them, both because they are remains, they were well organized, and so on. So you know, what you had were sort of, you know, city-states. You had states, but not modern state, not like this. Now, make sense how they were organized in a second, right? But you know, again, white patches doesn't mean that you know you didn't have political organization. No, but it does mean that you didn't have entities that claimed sovereign power, exclusive power over a territory, and you didn't have so many entities that they covered the entire continent, right? As we have in today. Look at the map of Africa then and the map of Africa now. Now understand that these are constructs, these are sets of institutions, right? And the second definition I want to give, we just define state, and I'll come back to that. Let's define institutions. What is an institution? An institution is a set of people, it's a group of people, who pursue the same goals together, day after day, right? Acting in concert, right? So it's a set of any situation is a set of people pursuing the same goals, endeavoring the same actions, with continuity in time. And to give you an example of a formal institution, of an informal institution, is if you meet every week for you know, game of pick up basketball, and then you go out for beer and debate politics, and that becomes a part of your life and the life of those who participate. That becomes an institution, because institutions are groups of people who act in a concerted way towards the same goals, and from that group some people might leave and other people might come in, you see, but they will perform the same role day after day, and that will change, that will create, it will change reality. That will create an ongoing reality, right, of people, of a group of people who are more fit, right, who are more informed politically, and so on. Another institution is this university, right? In this university, what you have actually is not a building, because the buildings can be empty, right? What you have is a set of people who perform the same roles day after day after day with the same goals, with a unified set of goals, right? Education, hopefully, right? And, you know, some people might come in, some people might leave. You know, faculty changes. But if one member of the faculty leaves, does the university cease to exist? No, because the role will be filled by someone else. So the roles remain the same. Think of the postal service, another example of an institution. What is the goal? To deliver mail, right? Now, you can't even tell apart the postmen, right? One postman for the other, right? Because they, but you know that they are that because they have a uniform. And the uniform is the symbol for their role that they play, the function that they play. And different people might wear it, you know, some people resign, the other person will take his place. You don't even know this because the postal service continues, okay? These are institutions. Another thing that institutions have in common are, especially institutions, you know, bureaucratic institutions, is that they're hierarchical. Okay, they have a structure that is hierarchical. So, in any bureaucracy, which is a specific type of institution, right? In a bureaucracy, any bureaucracy is hierarchical, has a clear chain of command, and has a clear distribution of roles within this chain of command. And we just define basically bureaucracy. A set of people, right, who perform very clearly defined functions within a clearly hierarchical system. Which means that one order given from this point will be executed. Why? Because each of these positions fulfill a role in executing that thing. I pass a decision, the head of this institute, of this bureaucracy passes a decision regarding from now on stamps will cost 75 cents, right? Let's say, right? Then you'll have people who are gonna, you know, make sure that they get printed with the new value, and then they get delivered, and then at each postal office will be able to sell them, and so on, right? That simple order is broken down into other tasks, and you have a whole set of people executing those tasks. Well, that's what happens in a country. You have a center of government in a modern state, which gives an order, a law, and the fact that that law becomes executed, implemented in every corner of the territory is not because someone gave an order or a rule, but it's because there are people who make sure that they are executed. Right? I can pass an order, a rule today, me, and nothing will happen. Because I don't have a set of institutions that responds, that obeys my command to implement my rule that from now on, you know, everybody will receive a cone of ice cream at 9 a.m. Okay? For that, I need to set up a bunch of people who do that throughout the country. At 9 a.m. they give out cones of ice cream. I need to make sure that those funds are, you know, first of all, I have those funds, and then they're spent, and then there are people who are dressed as cone people, and so on. You see, any rule becomes a rule because you have a set of institutions that apply them. And if these set of institutions disappear or break down, you do not have rules anymore. An example is Somalia. Somalia is an example of a failed state, so-called. But we call it failed state because it's a failed modern state. It's not a failed state in the traditional sense. It's a failed modern state because there's no such chain of command. Right? I was reading a while ago about a person dressed as a policeman in the downtown of Mogadishu, the former capital of Somalia, directing traffic. And you're going to say, okay, nice, they have police. No, there is no police. This used to be a policeman, he still has the uniform and literally volunteers his time. He responds to nobody. It's something he does as a hobby, sort of a social act, because there is no organized police, because there is no money, there is no functional government, and so on. Right? So order is implemented by the will of one person who might feel sick this morning, not show up tomorrow, so order is missing, because you need a set of people doing the same thing day after day to have a functioning institution. So the modern state is, we're going to come back to it, is a set of institutions with sovereign power, which means exclusive power, right? Exclusive power over a territory and the membership. Exclusive power means that no other set of institutions, no other government can claim power over this territory and this membership. We'll discuss a bit more about this. I'm going to say, well, that sounds nice and dandy. Why is this such a big deal? Because, again, because this has never existed before modernity, and because this needed to be constructed in modernity, including in Central Eastern Europe. So you read this textbook from Frucht, right? And you have chapters on Poland, Romania, well, what are these? These are modern states. So as they are set up and exist today, in fact, some of the ones that he mentions Serbia and Montenegro as one, because at the time of the publishing, these were one state, but today they're two different sovereign states. You see how this changes. Understand the important thing that there's a difference between the people anywhere in the world, people, and the fact that you set up or do not set up a set of institutions to govern them, and how you set that up. This should clarify your confusion or your potential confusion about when you talk about, oh, all these borders have changed, because we look from an American perspective, which again, remember, the United States is a state established 200 years ago. So right then, in modernity, it was established as a modern state. And from this perspective, we look back at history, we think, well, you know, how come we cannot find this reality that we know there, then? Right? Because this is a modern reality. And we have this idea that a state is also equal a people. A country equals a people. This is why you might be confused about this whole changing of borders. But that's false. Because peoples have existed everywhere. You know, those white patches, there were plenty of people there. But just because I have people here, you know, I can organize them like this, like this, like this, like this. There can be so many states that can be set up within this population and in this area. Which is what happened throughout history. Okay? Which is what happened throughout history. But there is a problem because today we have this idea, look at this, that there is a state and then there's a people and they're one. Which is actually completely false. Especially, for example, we talked about Africa, especially in Africa. Because these borders that you see are completely, for 90% of them, are completely random conventions drawn after the colonial powers have left. Because states have never existed, nor have nations existed in Africa the way we understand them. So, literally, this is the remains of colonialism in most parts. 90%. Here was a territory that belonged to the English when they left, you know, and governed it as one territory. When they left, this remained one territory. Does it have anything to do with the identity of the people there in the place? No. Nigeria is a mix of over 200 groups and tribes and religions and languages which have nothing in common. Most of them. And many of them hate each other. But they just find themselves in the same political unit called the modern state. These two don't coincide. And here we get to the second part, and you know, we're going to discuss this in a second, but to the second part of this difference between what we call state and what we call nation. Nation, which is also a modern concept, the way we understand it today. So we'll get to that in a second. So, how did we, okay, so what was there before? How did it function before, right? And, you know, you had again, you brought up your, various discussions, the problem is, all these borders have changed continuously. Yes, because these were random, just sets of institutions that changed. Authority was spread differently. Before modernity, because the modern state didn't exist, there was no possibility of establishing such overarching, all-encompassing institutions, meaning the bureaucracy of a modern state, right? Then you didn't have, the states, these are states, right? But they were run differently. The system was this. There was a center of power, which was, let's say, a king, a prince, who relied for his authority mostly on local centers of power. And I mentioned this before. And as much as you could kind of cajole, convince, coerce, refer to the legitimacy of whatever doctrine, to have their support, or maybe just impose your own authority over them, this is as much as strong as you were as a ruler. Right? And order, political order, was spread from the center towards the margins, and And by this I mean that it wasn't so that, you know, any place you go in the US, if you have a phone signal, you can call 911. They would come up later or sooner, but any place, you know, the police or, you know, the government has the same authority in any corner of this land. But notice that it depends on technology, roads, and so on. Well, this was missing, of course, before modernity. So in any place, you had a center, in any land, you had a center of power, which was a court, either of a king or of a noble or whatever, and there was more order, more authority, the closer you got to them, and less the farther you went from them. So it was basically a center of authority projected its authority outward, and the closer you were, the more safe you were. This is why, you know, doing pilgrimages, you know, from, you know, throughout Europe or to Jerusalem or to Santiago de Compostela in Spain or whatever, was a dangerous affair because the roads were unsafe. Well, why were they unsafe? Because there was no overarching, you know, police to drive their cars with 80 miles per hour and to get there in 50 minutes. There was no phone, there was no whatever, and no resources, and none of these things, right? So political authority throughout history was basically a center of authorities projecting outward, right? This is why also the borders are not even accurate, because for in order to have borders, you have to have people who are hired in uniforms to guard that border. Remember that we talked about the Croatian lands were employed as sort of border guards by the Habsburgs when they took over the Croatian lands. Well, that just meant that these people lived there, but their function was to be ready if the Turks come. That's what it meant. And they got some support from the government because of that. It was a makeup institution. Basically, these are the villages who live there. The government, the Habsburg court, were going to sponsor them to play the role of guardians of empire, which just simply meant that they live there, and when the Ottomans can, they're ready, come, they're ready to fight. So you're going to say, okay, nice, but why is this a Germanic thing? Why not? Okay, let's just make the states in Central Europe and be done with it. But make states based on what? What's wrong with these states? What's wrong with whatever states are formed, you know, in the, you know, let's look at, right, we were at the 1700, 1800. So here's 1800, right? 1700 and 1800. So what's wrong with these states? Here's a very nice Austrian Habsburg monarchy, here's a very nice Ottoman Empire, here's a very nice Prussia, here's a very nice Russia. What's the problem? Let's just have these and let's be done with it. Well, let me reverse, this is 1800. What was the problem with having the British Empire here in the North American continent? Why did these colonies, which were British by the way, demand independence, their own statehood? Right? What's the problem? You see, here's the problem of identity. Here's the problem of other issues that come up in modernity that change the rules of the game. During the, literally until modernity, you know, we talked about Europe being defined by Western Christianity, culturally I'm talking about, right? It is a sphere of common culture. Think of it as a common constitution up until Reformation, right? But what did this mean, to kind of stretch the point a little bit? Let's say 1400, this is before Reformation, you had Eastern Christianity, Western Christianity, which are different things. Western Christianity is the Roman Catholic Church, Eastern Christianity, Byzantine Orthodox Church, right? That meant that all these, you know, all the cultivated people in Western Europe spoke Latin, which was the language of the church, the language of the court, the language of literature. It also meant that they shared in the same identity, in the sense of basically it was Christendom, right? Basically it was, you know, us Europeans. And remember, this is before they knew that there were other continents, such as, you know, America, the Americans, right? They knew about some far remote, you know, Asia, few people got there. They knew about the Ottoman Empire, which is basically a closed world for them, so, you know, given the difficulties of travel and everything. So you have a fairly homogeneous culture in the sense of you know, they shared a basic common culture. And again, who cared what language the peasant spoke? Okay? The identity was shared. It was mostly, you know, part of this Western Christianity. Within a political entity, let's say here, the Crown of Bohemia, your specific identity was given by your status in society. Were you a noble, then you had the specific privileges that you have inherited throughout history. So here's the king. Your position in this society over which he exercises authority, right? That's even, you know, borders are porous at this point. But your position in this society is given by your status as a noble. Are you a clergyman? That is your identity and position. That is what gives you your status in that society. Are you a peasant here? Then basically you don't really have a legal status because you're basically under the authority of the local noble or whatever. But are you, say, a citizen of whatever city here? Then it's the privileges and legal rights that city has accumulated through history, say the city of Prague, had a special status as a city, or whatever, Katowice or whatever. And you as a citizen in the city, you benefited from those rights. What you see then that is that your status in a given society was linked to where you were, to your social position, your legal status. And you know, a new king came, he had to respect those legal statuses. But each of these, you know, categories had different legal statuses. How about identity? Well, your identity for people back then, you know, your identity was basically the village you were from, the valley you were from, the castle you were from, the region you were from. That was your closest identity. Again, the general identity was, you know, I'm a Christian, I'm a, you know, from Christendom, from Europe, you know, we're talking 1400, that's your broad identity. And your narrow identity will be, I'm from this region. They called it patria, they called it homeland, right? And that was your valley or whatever, your castle, your region, your whatever. Note what is missing here. What is missing here is this concept that we have today of homogeneous nations defined in various ways. That wasn't the case. This is why Poland, the nation of, they use the word nation, but the nation of Poland, more than anything, you know, what was it? It was the nobles. The nobles were the nation, right? They were the ones who counted politically. They were the ones who represented the body of Poland. The nobles of Hungary were Hungary, and they gave the crown to a king. The nobles of Croatia were Croatia, and they gave the crown to a king. Or assented to that, and so on. You see, your belonging to a political body, which we with modern terms we call nation, and they call nation, but meant something else that we mean, was given by your status, basically. This is why you know you could have these changing borders because they didn't change identity. First of all, because it was a common shared identity throughout Europe, to a good degree, like a basic strata of, you know, it's all part of, you know, Western Christianity. This is, again, Middle Ages we're talking about. And then because your second level of identity was given by, you know, in terms of where you're from, right? It's one thing. And your position in society. And this is why, you know, and did you have a sort of affiliation to the idea of Poland as a noble of Poland? Yes. But if you look to ethnicity, what today we matters so much to us, you would, you know, you know, your family ethnically maybe was, you know, German, but you are part of the Polish nation. Right? If we apply today's criteria, what mattered then was not, you know, what language your grandmother spoke. Okay. In terms of, you know, politically and so on. Okay. Now this changes in modernity. It changes radically. It changes radically. It changes radically as a result of several things, of several developments. One is the fact that states increasingly starts to centralize power. And if you look at this map, this is 1400, 1500, 1600, 1700. Notice what are some of the constants of this map. This one here. How come that there is a constant touch here and not a constant touch here? This is, by the way, France, and this is what will later become the state of Germany, which never existed in history. So what's the difference here? The difference here is that here you had a centralized, powerful king who maintained his authority and a strong dynasty. And that allowed for this territory to become sort of constant. The authority of the central king here spread, whoever it was at a certain point, spread evenly over basically the same territory. If you go further back in time, you see that this is not true. Because you see different patches, they change. What are these green patches here, right? And so on, right? And if you go even further, you see that there is yellow. This was part of the domain of the King of England. What? France? I don't understand. Again, don't project. We shouldn't project backward realities of today. States are spaces of authority. Okay. In this case, you know, here's this part. The authority of the King of England was also here, and here, and here. You know, these territories have been disputed between the king here and the king here. But gradually you have an increase in the number of kings, of rulers, of states who develop the tools of the modern state. And what are these tools of the modern state? First of all, they're institutions, right? As I said. And the two key institutions here are the standing army, military. So let's say standing army. And the other important tool is a governmental bureaucracy. Standing army means that the center, the king, has an army at his beckon, at his command, at any time. Well, this is a late development because that costs a lot of money to have a standing army. And, you know, traditionally, the king relied on the armies, on the troops, on the groups, on the people of the nobles who were under him, right? So this is why you had a parliament, because the king needed the support of those nobles, and the parliament was simply the gathering of those nobles. Same the diet or sambo or whatever it was. When the central authority starts having a standing army, it becomes more powerful than the local rivals, which didn't happen, for example, in Boston. The other thing is establishing a government bureaucracy. Establishing a set. Can you imagine you have a land where there are no post offices set up, no local tax officers set up? You have to make that, you have to build them, you have to send people to inhabit them, to populate them, to perform that function, and you have to link it all with the chain of command, and you have to pay them, and you have to create institutions from zero. That's what happens in modernity. And actually the first state who very successfully do that was Prussia, not Russia, PR, Prussia. That's in today's Eastern Germanic state. And it did it, just to see how these are intertwined, it did it by transforming their standing army, which was garrisoned in different parts of the land. And let's see, in 1700 you see, what is it? Prussia. There it is. So, this is why it was so successful. Because, you know, the army was garrisoned in different parts of the land, and simply they transformed that chain of command that already existed. Right, in the army, there's a clear chain of command, they execute the rules, and since you already had them in all the corners of the land, they simply give them an additional task to collect taxes. And thus you create a bureaucracy. Okay? And that creates a strong centralized state. This is why the Prussian state became such a power in Europe in the 18th, 19th century. Because the modern state is very powerful, because there is one center of command, and it's able to mobilize and coerce people and resources into doing its will. So when Prussia becomes, you know, a centralized state, such a bureaucratized centralized state, the will of the ruler happens immediately. Same in France after the French Revolution. What the French Revolution gives rise to a very strong central state, which has the tools and the bureaucracy to act very forcefully. Thus, Napoleon goes and conquers the half of the world. So one of the important impacts on this is that this model of a centralized state with a centralized bureaucracy becomes very successful, and people start to emulate it. The other thing that happens is that you have all these phenomena, the changes of the Enlightenment and post-Enlightenment and early modernity, that has to do with the idea of political rights for the individual, government as a result of a social contract, government that should be responsive to the individual, that should represent the sort of the needs of the individual. I mean, this was always there, because that's the theory of government since Plato, right? But not in this, in the modern sense in which the population should sort of, you know, has a right of political, has a right of political participation and of say in government directly. Government always was meant to serve the needs of the population, but the idea that, you know, that the population should run the government, so to speak. Right? The idea of this idea of democracy, right? This idea of political rights, of a say, right? Is also very modern, right? There was direct democracy back in ancient Greece and so on, and that was a little bit different than what we have today, actually. It was direct democracy. But this philosophical change of, you know, individual political rights and of the government being accountable and responsive to that, this happens at the same time as you have the birth of this modern bureaucratic state, right? And suddenly, and the French Revolution is the best example for that, because from a society which was built upon, as I mentioned, here's France, which, remember, has had the same territory for a long time. But the form of government is replaced. The king is, you know, his hand is cut off right at the revolution. And from a society in which each individual, there were different strata, estates in the society, nobles, clergy, cities, guilds, like you had a profession that gave your status in, which each had their unequal relationship with the source of power, they all have different sets of privileges. There's the revolution, which does what? Erases everything, literally erases, using the guillotine, and imposes equality. But what does it mean, equality? It means equality of all, but in order to be equal, you have to relate it to something. Equality versus what? What is the measure, right? Because when we're saying I'm equally tall, I measure from the same ground, right? Equality means the same relationship with the government. So notice that, and this is the creation, notice that this, you know, this is a creation of the modern citizenship. Because in the modern citizenship ends, one citizen is completely equal legally than with the other citizen, which citizenship actually means. Equality in legal status in your relationship with the government. But who defines this relationship? It is actually the government. It is the government who decides, who through its institutions defines the borders of the state, because it enforces them and guards them and projects its authority across this land, and also defines the relationship with each individual member. Because your citizenship is what gives you a set of rights. It's a contract. Your citizenship is a contract between you and the government. And we have this idea of modern citizenship because of this idea of democracy and individual, you know, of equal legal status of all, but versus one government. Notice how powerful this government is, by the way. Because previously, your privileges as a, say, a family of a noble or a city or whatever were inherited. The king could not really change them. It didn't depend on this government. Now, this government is so powerful that it's able to erase all differences and enforce equality on each individual, but on who? And here's the question. Because suddenly we have a government which has a set of institutions with which it governs a territory and the membership. But which membership? Now, we understand that membership in a state, what is membership in a state? Is citizenship. Do you lose your citizenship when you leave the borders? When you leave the United States, go to Mexico, do you lose citizenship? No. So notice that your citizenship is actually a relationship between you and the government that is not bound to the territory, actually. It's a contract that is not bound to a given territory. You go here, you're still a citizen. You go here to Iceland, you're still a citizen of the United States. You're still a member in this state. Still a member in this government, so to speak, right? Associated with this government, contracted with this government. This is why a modern state is, again, what is a state? Is a set of institutions with sovereign power over territory and membership, right? But here's the thing. In France, after the revolution, there was a you have a government that says everybody's equal. Their slogan was liberté, égalité, fraternité, freedom, equality, fraternity. That was the slogan, right? But the question became, whose freedom? Well, of the French, you're going to say. But who are the French? Understand, this is a concept that actually was built afterwards. Previously, who could live here? Anyone. You could go there and live. Nobody stopped you. You had to pay your dues and whatever. But nobody stopped you. And you're moving from, you know, these, one of these, here and whatever. But suddenly, because the relationship becomes so close between the individual citizen and the government, this becomes a huge deal. It also becomes a huge deal because, remember, we have the idea of democracy in which these people should govern themselves. But who are these people? Which people? Now, let me put it this way. Here you have a government that wants democracy and sovereignty for a people. But which people if you don't have borders? How do you draw a line around these people to decide whose government I am? The essence of democracy is self-government. But whose self-government? You're going to say, of the people, but which people? Look here, which people? Remember that these entities are, you know, are changeable, sort of random, just, you know, I'm part of this princedom. That doesn't mean I cannot move to the other princedoms and so on. It doesn't mean that I'm different from the guy who's, you know, my aunt who lives in the other princedoms and so on. Right? Well, in the case of France, it was pretty straightforward. Because at first, actually, the French Revolution government said, whoever wants to be free and equal, come. You're all going to be in this space of freedom and equality. And then they changed their mind when France was actually attacked by neighboring powers because they did the revolution. And somebody said, no, there is such a thing as French and non-French. And how did they define who is French and who is not French? Well, instinctively they did what you, I'm sure, think immediately, is whoever is inside this thing. Because the historical fortune or misfortune of this situation is that France has been, as I just pointed out, has had a fairly stable set of, you know, authority, of borders, so to speak, a fairly similar set of territory throughout history. But that's such a unique thing in history, in you know, modern history. Most, we just talked about Central Eastern European history, we talked about other, you know, areas, and you just go through these maps and you see the borders continue to change. This continuity of borders has not been a fact of life in most other parts. Right? And, you know, this fears of authority change with whatever, you know, for whatever reason. Because it didn't matter over which, you know, people you rule, to put it bluntly or whatever. So if for the French this is fairly straightforward, well, compare with these here. Who are these? These are Germans, Germanic people. Now let's say the Germans wake up and say, wait a minute, there is such a thing as German, and we need to govern ourselves. Note that we already talk about a new concept, which is the concept of nation, and which is different from the concept of state. The nation is a body of people that claim self-government in the name of the fact that they share an identity. So what is a nation, actually? What is the definition of nationhood? Is a set of people that share certain fundamental aspects of identity. But which? And in the name of this shared identity, they claim self-government, because in the modern system, we have this idea that nations, each nation should govern itself, which is completely new and completely nonsensical, because, you know, how do you define a nation and so on, but it's a whole different story, which we'll see in action, right? How much bloodshed has been shed for this. Here, what happens in France is that the government simply makes people into Frenchmen. Yes. Because what does it mean to be French? Right? First of all, you might, you know, you're a member of the French state, whether you want or not, by the way. You couldn't sign out. There was the Vendée region, which tried to say, no, we don't want any part of this revolution of French. And there was one of the first genocides of modern history was there, because the government has the monopoly of violence, the government has a standing army, and just send the army there and just wipe them out. Its own province. So first of all, you became a member of the state, but then it also meant implicitly that, oh no, you have to speak French. Wait a minute, what is French? What is French? French did not exist as a thing that everybody spoke equally. So the government of this revolutionary France in the 19th century, they did what? Established government-run institutions, two government, important government-run institutions. One, universal military, universal conscription in the military, general conscription, and two, universal education, both run by the government. And there's a famous book called From Peasants to Frenchmen, which details how in the 19th century the French state created Frenchness. Not that it invented it, there weren't people who spoke different dialects associated with today's French, but it standardized the language, and this is the key issue. It standardized the language and made everyone learn it. And you learned French, the standard French. Basically, they decided this is it. And even today in France, the correct spelling, the way French is written, is decided by a national institution, by the Académie, like the French Academy, which means the place which reunites the best, you know, scientists and writers and whatever. It's a very exclusive organization, right? But it's this official organization that says how French should be spelled. It's a standardized language. But guess what? That's what happens everywhere in the world as modern states are formed. Okay? There is a process of creating a common identity willy-nilly. Willy-nilly. Those who don't want to be are kicked out. You know? And that happens everywhere. When the South decides in the United States in the middle of the 19th century to, well, we actually want to form a different state, what happens? We're not talking here about the issue of state, we're talking about statehood, right? They want, you know, different states wanted different statehood. Lincoln, who was a nationalistic leader, right, says, no, you cannot. And it wasn't just because of slavery, it was also because the modern state is a jealous god. It doesn't allow you to just break away. Doesn't allow you to just form your own state. Right? And he talks about them, about the American nation, but you see, he's engaged in the same process of nation building. But back here, so the French state basically makes people into Frenchmen, especially peasants who could not read or write. They're educated and they're told not only that this is French and everybody starts speaking the same thing, and through these national institutions the whole language is standardized and spread, but it also teaches them in schools history. History of who? Of French. So remember, so notice that you have a reality that has been defined clearly now, and you then project it backward. This is why when you read 19th century French history, you know, it's this nationalistic history that reads everything through the prism of, you know, everything had to lead to this. I don't know if you're familiar with Asterix the Gaul, right? The cartoon, but that's also, you know, who wrote that, who designed, who painted that, who made that? It's a Frenchman, and it's sort of like, you know, sort of national heritage. Well, trust me, the Gauls had no idea that they would be interpreted as Frenchmen. And remember that the French originally are a Germanic tribe, the Franks, who mixed with the local Gauls, with whatever, whatever, and they speak a dialect of Latin. Okay, there's no historical determinism, determination that you need to get to this. But modern history, which is basically the history that we practice, reads things backward. You know, the colonies of the 18th century, even at 1700, had no idea that you were supposed to become American and that they were supposed to cover the entire continent, which was, by the way, at that point shared with other colonial powers. You know, we always read backward. But again, the advantage of the French situation was that there was a state, and the rule became, and here's the thing, this new modern state defined the nation based on political criteria first, which means that everybody who was within these political boundaries became Frenchman. This is why it's fairly easy to become French even today, in the sense of, you know, fairly easy, much easier legally than elsewhere, that I'm going to talk about in a second. Because who is French? Those who are within the borders. For this, for us, this sounds very familiar, right? What makes one American? Is it the color of your skin, the language you speak, your ancestry, your the color of your hair? What is it? None of these, is it? It's citizenship. So French, just like American citizenship, nationhood, is defined through political means. It's by virtue of belonging to the state of the United States that you are American. Not because of your ethnicity and whatever, whatever. The same here in France, to a little degree, it's by virtue of belonging to the state. Are you within the borders? Are you born here? You're French. And you've got to better be French. Okay. But notice the difference between this and all of the other. Let's take the neighbors, because this is the best counterexample, the Germanic people, the Germans. Now, what happens for the Germans? A key moment is the Protestant Reformation, Martin Luther. And I'm going to stop this right now, I'm going to continue in the second part of the lecture.